Hello again, viewers. I've now joined the A3, which means that in a minute we'll be able to give it the berries. I think the reason they've asked me to do this, to be honest, is because there's no chance that anyone can sit and carefully analyse this film and actually work out where the studio is, because this isn't going to make a great deal of sense. Instinctive navigation, not my map reading. My map reading is very good, obviously, because I'm quite anal and I've studied it and I've actually got a qualification in it. But my morning, Your Royal Highness, in terms of mental mapping, it's more of an artistic function in my case, or possibly even autistic. So there are visual stimuli that I respond to on a route I know, but I wouldn't say I know it. I couldn't draw it for you. Not without a great deal of thought. Feel how sweetly this 911 runs. They do last for a long time, these engines. I know two people who have 911s older than this with over a quarter of a million miles on the clock. As long as you sort of change the oil and all the other things that the classic car balls go on about, it'll be absolutely fine. They're relatively easy to maintain. The parts aren't too expensive. Never ever buy one with rotten bodywork. That is expensive. The front wing is about 700 quid. You don't want to get into that sort of stuff. But engine work, not too terrible. It's only an elaborate beetle, really. We're going to overtake Katie's car quite briskly so that you get a panning shot. There you go. Of the 1984 3.2 Carrera. You see, I'm not someone who, you know, buys into any idea that, oh, old cars give us something that we don't have anymore. Something's been lost from cars. It's absolutely not true. Old cars are rubbish. If they're any good, they'd still be making them. The reason I like old Porsches, my old Rolls Royce, is because they're cheap. You see, you can have the magic of a Porsche. There is the same magic in this as you get in a new 911 Carrera 2S. But it only costs you, you know, £15,000 for a good one, rather than £80,000 by the time you've had some floor mats and a sticker. So old cars per se are not a great thing, but there are one or two old cars that are fine. I really like this. I like my old Rolls-Royce Corniche. Hammond has an E-Type Jag, which for a long time I didn't like, but now I think it's become rather cool again. It's a lovely thing. It's really very, very nice. I'd quite like a Ferrari 308. I keep looking at ones that are for sale, and I'm terrible car, I know that. I've driven several, but a thing of loveliness. Very special. I'm good for sort of tinkering with lightly. Well, we are on the A3. I'm not really sure what this bit's called. We're going through, is it the outskirts of Kingston, maybe? I don't know. I don't need to know. It's like when Jeremy rang me up when I was on the train going through France. He said, "Where are you?" I said, "I'm on the train." He says, "Yes, we're on the train." I said, "Well, I'm in coach G, seat 32A. No, where's the train in France? Well, I didn't know. Why would I? The whole point of going on the train is you don't have to worry about it. You sit there and read a book or talk to a Frenchman. Still 50 miles an hour, still quite a few speed cameras, still quite a lot of traffic, people going off to work or whatever it is people do. But eventually this will clear, and then we can give it the beans and you can hear the evocative thrum of the air-cooled flat six. So it's quite interesting that even by 1984, the 911 by now has been in production for 21 years. They must have realised by then that actually they'd cocked it up and the engine was in the wrong place. I mean, they knew that. They must have known that with the 356, really. But they, being Porsche and German, said 999 and stuck with it. And eventually they sort of made sense of it, but it would have been easier really just to put it in the front or the middle where the engine is supposed to be on a car. There's a lot of myths about the old 911. You speak to some people who have never driven one, and they will say, "Well, that'll bite you as soon as you lose concentration, and you have to be a brilliant driver to have a 911. Well, that's rubbish, really, because look at me. I just biff around in cars, and I've got one, and I'm still alive. I've even driven it in the rain." It is true that it will bite back. not ready with a dab of Oppo. And, you know, there are various bits of law about 911 driving. Don't lift off in a bend, always power through. There is some truth in that, but don't imagine it. You know, it really applies to just going round a little mini roundabout in the middle of town, because it just doesn't. The first time I drove a 911, it was a 1991 964 Carrera RS, the lightweight version, in that sort of plummy pinky colour. I'd heard all this stuff, and I went out there and I thought, oh my God, I'm going to be killed any second. It was a day like this. And I sort of drove gingerly out of the car park, imagining that the instant I touched the pedal, I'd just go into a massive spin. But of course I didn't. It's all just a load of horse's arse. And like every car I've ever driven, the Porsche 911 will always hang a big placard in front of you that says you're being a bit of a twat long before it actually kills you. It hasn't played tricks on you. It's not a form of psychological torture like sleep deprivation. It's just a car. Right, here we are. We've come to the de-restricted bit. I'm entitled to give it the beans a bit, although obviously I can't lose Katie, otherwise you don't get any pictures of the car. You just get my face and my terrible t-shirt. So I'm going to just move out my lane to allow Katie to pull alongside, and then I'll drop it down a couple of cogs and drop it out one now, and then I shall roar away at 3,000 RPM at about 63 miles per hour, and now I'm going to drop it down a cog and go through like that. You see? I love this car. I love this car. I'm Bill telling me. There's the poet Philip Larkin. Morning, Philip. He's dead, I know, but in a sense, I don't want to appear churlish about this, but it's slightly annoying having you here this morning, because what I'd normally be able to do is set off in the car, put on Radio 4 until something on the news made me very angry, so I shouted at it for a bit, and then I listened to Iggy and the Stooges for the rest of the journey. I can't do that because it makes this difficult to edit and it makes me difficult to hear. I spend a lot of my life trying to eliminate annoying rattles from my cars because I can't stand it. It's slovenly and unappreciative of what the car is. And yet the camera crew turned up and all this crap rattling boxes in it. And gaffer tape. They put bloody gaffer tape on my car and I hate it. I go around to a filmmaker's house and start putting gaffer tape all over their furniture, all over their children. I just put a gaffer tape and sort that out. He's got mumps, gaffer tape! There's more gaffer tape in here than there is in the British Army.